The meeting to order, please. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Councilmember Francisco.
Here.
Hart.
Here.
Hotchkiss.
Here.
Rouse.
Here.
White. Mayor Pro Tem Murillo.
Here.
Mayor Schneider.
Okay. And the mayor will be joining us in a few minutes. The only thing I would say is to try not to block the door in the back. And we have ceremonial items. Thank you.
Item one, employee recognition service award pins.
Yes, Madam Mayor and members of the council, as you know, every month we celebrate employees who have important anniversaries with the city, and this month we have several, and I'd like to read their names into the record, and we have three employees here today to receive their pins in person. So first, with 10 years, Debbie Bush, the executive assistant to the mayor and council, Danny Trejo, warehouse lead in public works, Claire Turner, human resource analyst in admin services, and Juan Ramirez, senior water distribution operator in public works. With 15 years, Brandon Baudette, administrative analyst 3 in public works, Bradley Klein, maintenance worker 2 in public works, Fred DeWitt, heavy equipment technician in public works, and Ann Van Belkom, who's the administrative assistant in public works. With 20 years, Leanna Penchek, who's the legal office supervisor in the city attorney's office, John Ornalis, senior water distribution operator in public works, and Pete Conception Jr., who's the airport maintenance supervisor in the airport. We have three employees here to receive pins today. The first is Stacy Wilson, associate transportation planner in public works, then Richard Gutierrez, maintenance worker 2 in public works, and with 30 years, Judd Conley, who's the waterfront maintenance supervisor.
Thank you, Mr. Armstrong. I'm so glad everyone's here today for this. Congratulations to everyone. But we'll start with 25 years.
Thank you.
And I'm going to read this into the record. Anastasia Stacy Wilson began her career with the City of Santa Barbara on August 14, 1989, as a clerk for Public Works Engineering. In August 1990, she was promoted to Traffic Tech 1 in Public Works Transportation, then to Traffic Tech 2, Assistant Transportation Planner, and in 2005 to Associate Transportation Planner, the position she holds today. Stacy, a valued member of the Transportation Division, is the longest tenured transportation planning employee. She works with applicants reviewing projects as well as a single car garage to as large as the traffic and planning impact analysis of the Cottage Workforce Housing Project. Stacy was recognized as the recipient of the Public Works Employee of the Month Award for her work resolving the Alano Club and Mental Wellness Center appeal. That was a big one. Stacy's forte is the ability to engage applicants and staff at a personal level that creates a welcoming feeling, which is an indispensable strength in public customer service and creating unity among city employees. Stacy has faced and overcome adversities in ways that are an inspiration to staff and those close to her. She continues to use those personal experiences to invest in others. Stacy enjoys all things elegantly shiny and likes to create fused glass jewelry and spends as much time as possible in her personal life intertwined with friends and family. Stacy, it is my pleasure to honor you today for your 25 years of service to the City of Santa Barbara. We congratulate you on your admirable achievement. And say a few words.
Thank you. Aw, thank you. That's so nice. So nice. Thank you. Okay, aw, thank you very, very much. That's just really nice. My gosh, I didn't know what to expect in there, so it's just really, it was very personalized. And thank you very much for what you wrote, Steve. I know you're the man right there. And so I just wanted to say a couple words. Like, I came to the city for a job with pay and medical benefits, and I fell in love. And I started in engineering, and I immediately fell in love with the hustle and the bustle, and the phones were ringing, and it was going crazy. And what I loved about it is there was the opportunity to help people. Like, people just called in. They needed help. They needed to figure out how things were going or what was going on their street. Or then we went into the drought and all that. And so that was just my passion. It's like getting an answer for somebody. And you know, really, that's what how I consider my job, is like I've just been able to help people along the way. And, you know, I've been in transportation for all but 1 year. And what I do with people there is, as you heard a little bit about it, but, you know, I get to help the applicant who's right in front of me. It's either through plans or they're just right there in front of me. But I also help the neighbor who's, you know, not there right in front of me, or the community, you know, and that's through policies and the standards that we have. And I really take both sides of that very seriously. And, you know, a big part is saying no sometimes. You know, like, hopefully we can reshape a project so that it works within, you know, what our guidelines are. But, you know, we have to, as staff, say no sometimes. And it's been a really big learning part of growing up, really, for me. But what I want to talk about is just like some of the benefits that, thank you. I want to say thank you for some of the things that the city has offered. Like, you know, we have like I said, I came from medical benefits, and then there was a retirement system here, and I'm really grateful for that. And then there's the deferred compensation program. And, you know, I participated in that from the very beginning, and that's what's really going to ensure that I'll be able to eat when I retire. It is. So for that reason, I do like to work with new employees and see if I can talk with them about that and getting started on a small basis, because that's how most things start, is really small. And I know that I need help, so I figure other people do too. And, you know, I wish Rob Dayton were here today, because, you know, he and I have worked together for 23 years, and that's every day. You know, I've seen him more than I've seen anybody else in my life. And that's funny. And we've had good times and bad times, but I mean, it's just an amazing thing. That's what that's what all of this is about people. And so I want to say thank you to all the people in my life. I want to thank the generous people that are my coworkers, and in particular, in 2012, my husband got sick and died. During that time, it's okay, because it, you know, it's a sad thing, but anyway, gosh darn it. What I want to say is thank you, because everybody supported me emotionally, spiritually, and what is so incredible is financially. There's a program at the city where people can make contributions of their discretionary funds, like vacation funds. And my coworkers took care of me. And this is a community, and this is my family, and this is all about people. And it's about people working one-on-one with an applicant who comes in, or people working one-on-one about talking about what's available for our futures, or people working one-on-one to support one another. So thank you. Thank you for being here for me.
Is Juan Gutierrez here? Oh no, he didn't come? Well, we'll keep his prizes here. Judd Conley? Yay! Judd Conley began his career with the City of Santa Barbara in 1981 as an hourly maintenance worker at Stearns Wharf, and in August 1984 began a full-time position as waterfront maintenance worker too. Due to his strong work ethic and innovations, he was promoted to Stearns Wharf supervisor in 1986. In 1998, Judd became the harbor supervisor upon being transferred to the harbor. In 2003, he was appointed to his current position, waterfront maintenance superintendent. Judd has been part of the Waterfront Facilities Division from its inception in an effort to provide the best public facilities and service possible. He has experimented, studied, created, and developed numerous ways to maintain equipment, buildings, and structures which have been subjected to the harsh marine environment on Stearns Wharf and in the harbor. Expecting the unexpected, Judd has learned that Mother Nature can present challenges, including wharf fires and El Nino storms. Judd has worked to foster an atmosphere of enjoyment and teamwork, making the waterfront an agreeable and fulfilling place to work. Over the last 30 years, Judd has worked with hundreds of employees responsible for repairing and maintaining the waterfront's facilities. Judd is well respected by all and takes pride in his 21-year relationship with Work Inc., providing much needed and appreciated employment for some of Santa Barbara's most special citizens. Special events, including the 4th of July and the Harbor Seafood Festival, attract thousands of people and go off without a hitch thanks to Judd and his dedicated crew. Judd is a dedicated employee who takes pride in his contributions to the evolving, many times challenging, but never boring elements that make up the waterfront. He has been and continues to be instrumental in keeping Santa Barbara's waterfront the safely maintained and beautiful destination it is today. Judd, I'm very pleased to recognize your 30 years of service, as well as your many personal and professional accomplishments. And on behalf of all the City Council, we congratulate you on this outstanding achievement.
Madam Mayor, and Madam Mayor Pro Tem Murillo, and honorable members of the City Council, and all the people that showed up today, I appreciate that a great deal. I'd like to take this opportunity that I've worked so long for the City of Santa Barbara and provided service. I can't believe it. It's been 30 years. It's like I wake up and then it's 30 years from now. So, what's really strange is I'm only halfway through my career. And then the big thing is I would like to recognize and thank my lovely wife, Marilee, over here sitting down. Every morning she nudges me and says, get up, you got to go to the waterfront. And then the other thing is I'd like to thank my wonderful staff over here, especially Don Dwyer, who I've worked with 24 years. He and I really put together a really good team. Carl Triberg, the managers and supervisors, Scott Reedman, the new business manager, I can't think of his name, but no, I'm just, but the other thing is I'd just like to say thank the Waterfront Department for being so patient with me and keeping me on my toes for the entire 30 years. It's been truly a blessing, a privilege, and a pleasure, and an honor to work for the City of Santa Barbara. Thank you very much.
Congratulations. My apologies for being a little tardy, and thank you to Pro Tem Maria for continuing on time. So with that, do we have any changes to the agenda?
No, there aren't, Madam Mayor.
Okay. So if you're leaving, if you could bring your conversations to outside the room so we can continue with the meeting. And for public comment, we have quite a few speakers wanting to speak and others waiving their time to the speaker. So I will ask if you're in the room to make sure we can coordinate that. We have a couple more here. Okay. So we will start. Hold on, let me just make sure. It's okay. We'll start with Chris Cassie or Casey. And is Frank Hernandez here? There you are, and you're ceding your time to Mr. Kess. Okay, so is it
Chris Kachi.
Kachi, you have up to 4 minutes.
Okay.
And why don't you bring that mic right down to you. There you go. And then it'll be followed by Mike Woods.
Okay, I'd like to address the homeless problem, I'll call it, homeless industry. On a nationwide, it's a $1 trillion industry. Here in Santa Barbara, it's a very lucrative cottage industry. Let me give you an example here. There's a mayor and there's a city. I'm not going to say who the mayor is. I'm not going to say who the city is. The mayor sits on 8 seats over a 10-year period and draws, I think it was $870,000, and came up empty-handed as far as any solutions go. Now, let me add to this locally, a woman by the name of Mary. She's called Crazy Mary. She's one of Reagan's kids. She's not one of, not to be confused with Jerry's. She lives in her wheelchair. She lives in one of two parks. At about 2 o'clock in the morning, 1 o'clock in the morning, she slips out of her wheelchair, and she does her business about 200 feet from locked city public bathrooms. I think just that could be a, that analogy could be a metaphor for the way the city wants to treat the homeless problem. We all know that you don't want to treat the homeless problem in the benefit of the homeless because it's a very lucrative industry, a very lucrative industry, especially when you discriminate against senior citizens, you discriminate against the handicapped, mentally, physically, otherwise, and you give, and you put them on 8 to 10-year waiting lists and then suddenly lose their paperwork, or they're suddenly bounced because some alcoholic or some drug addict that went through a program is promised and gets housing after 18 months at the expense of people who have spent their whole life working and don't get enough on Social Security to pay for housing. And then there's the other situation in dealing with the homeless problem with police going around in their outreach program. We have a whole squad of police attached to the homeless now, and they call it an outreach problem. And they go around and they give out tickets for public urination at night, again, a couple hundred feet from a locked public city bathroom. They go around knocking on doors of people who sleep in vehicles. They have to sleep in vehicles. They have to sleep. People have to sleep. It's a bodily function. They go around at 2 o'clock in the morning. They shine their flashlights in their windows. They issue tickets. They show up for court because the person's not guilty, and they get time and a half for overtime for doing this. But it's quite an industry. Somebody's making bank off of these homeless people, this problem. The only one who's not gaining from this, gaining anything from this, are the homeless. But there's a lot of people making bank. If you want to apply for assisted housing, you get to see an attorney who probably gets about $200 an hour from the city to ask such questions of homeless people, a 70-year-old, or one of, again, one of Reagan's kids. What are your aspirations for the future?
You have about 20 seconds left.
My time up?
Yeah,
20
seconds left.
20 seconds left?
That's what she said. You
play
it less.
Again, there's the analogy. A public urination ticket 200 feet from a locked bathroom. That's the way the city wants to deal with the program.
Thanks. Mike Woods, and is Monica Bramond here? Okay, okay. So, Mr. Woods, you have up to 4 minutes, and you'll be followed by Ed McGregor.
Actually, Ed donated his time also, I think.
Yes, he did. So you have up to 6 minutes. We'll be followed by Rick Hubbard.
Thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Madam Clerk, I have some. Okay. Honorable Madam Mayor Snyder and Mayor Pro Tem Muriel and members of the council, my name is Mike Woods. And I'm a field representative for SEIU Local 620, who represent employees of the City of Santa Barbara. I am the chief spokesperson for the treatment and patrol units that are at the bargaining table, or were at the bargaining table with the city. We've been negotiating with the city for approximately 10 months. We have had around 22 meetings, consisting of 18 of those meetings being non-economic items or issues. And we only had 4 meetings for economic issues. The city has stated that we've had 22 meetings and we're unable to come to a compromise in a new contract. It is our position that the city negotiation team was under the impression that the economic proposals would only take one or two meetings, when it took 18 meetings just to accomplish the non-economic issues that we discussed. When we began this process, it was with the understanding of working with the city in a good faith effort to come to a mutual compromise for all those concerned. When we reached the point of impasse, the union was willing to continue negotiating through a state mediator to assist in the process. The city has no information in their charter about mediation or impasse procedures in the city charter. That's what we are informed of by the city. We met with the city twice and were not able to come to a compromise, even though the treatment patrol unit was willing to make considerable movement to get an agreement. After the first meeting, we told the city that we'd be willing to go to fact-finding because the city did not make one move during the first meeting. They discussed their stuff with the mediator. The mediator came back and convinced everyone on our team to have one more meeting. So we did. We set up another meeting that took about 2 weeks to set up and get together. At that time, you know, we ran out of the time frame, which is required by the new state law of doing fact-finding. Anyway, I'll move on from there. Then the city, in our opinion, retorted with aggressive regressive bargaining by moving the date of the effective proposed salary increases 2 months later from the prior proposal that they'd given to the union. They had actually offered to give us the pay raises in October of 2014. We were asking for July of 2014. During the mediation process, the city turned around and says, well, we'll give you the raises in December of 2014. We felt that was regressive. During this process of the mediation and arranging the dates, you know, like I stated earlier, we went beyond the time frames of that. You know, I had contacted a gentleman who is my counterpart at the table on the other side, who's done a lot of these fact findings, that I've had a decent relationship in the past with different cities that I work with him. He said that most of the agencies know about this problem with the mediation process and the fact finding, because the state gives you, once the mediator is assigned, you have 45 days to go through mediation and apply for fact-finding. It took 30 days just to get the mediator here. So 30 days was already gone before we even had our first mediation session. So, and again, PERB is aware of the problem. PERB thinks it's a lousy law that's written wrong, and they're trying to do something about it. One of the issues of concern to the union is that there was language in our prior contract with the city that expired on December 31st of 2013 that a salary, class, and compensation study was supposed to be completed 60 days before the end of the contract in December of 2013. And that was not started until the end of January 2014, approximately 6 months late. As these studies say, they take anywhere from 90 to 180 days to complete. This document would have been an important part of the economic process of the negotiations with the city. This document will show whether the TAP employees, the treatment patrol, are above or below the market for their job within the city in comparison to other agencies. At this point, the study is still in progress, and we don't feel that it will be completed within the next couple to 3 months. We do not believe that we are asking for anything unreasonable, considering that the employees of the treatment patrol unit have suffered right along with other units within the city. Our members gave up wages and took time off during the last contract, just like their counterparts within the city and elsewhere around the state and the country during the downturned economics. The city negotiation team has made the comment that the city wants to be fair across the board to all employees. Yet, they are holding a prior increase from the last contract that expired December 31st of 2013 against this unit. The city is costing that increase towards ongoing increases in the new contract, which should not have any effect as to how this contract is negotiated.
You have about 30 seconds left.
Okay. If the city wants to be fair, when they should look at the increases that were given to other units of the city at 2% per year of their contracts. If the city wants every employee to be equal, then they should not tell the bargaining units at the table when they ask for comparables to other units that they are different units and have different contracts. It was disconcerting to the treatment and patrol unit that the city is asking for a 2-year, 9-month contract, yet they are not willing to compensate the employees for that extra time frame when other units received have received more.
Thank you
for your time.
Thank you. Rick Hubbard, and then a number of people are waiving their time. Cynthia. I have Cynthia. I also have William Larson. Are you here, Mr. Larson? There you are. And Ryan Kelly. Okay, so you have up to 8 minutes. You don't need to take. You are? Okay, because you said to Rick Hubbard. Okay. So, no, you didn't. But William Larson did, yes. And Cynthia, you did. Okay, so up to 6 minutes. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Mayor and Council. My name is Rick Hubbard, and I have worked for the City of Santa Barbara for 13 years, and I'm currently representing the harbor in contract negotiations. I'm here to tell you today that the TAP unit worked hard to reach a contract with the city, but was unfortunate that negotiations broke down. The 10 officers of the Harbor Patrol represent the smallest and least paid of the three safety units in the city. Harbor Patrol is a high-risk job that encompasses many disciplines. As you all know, we are armed and sworn peace officers, just like the police department. We respond to fires with turnout gear, breathing apparatus, and also respond to medical calls, just like the fire department. We also respond to a number of boating emergencies at times in extremely hazardous conditions. We understand that a significant concern for the city during these negotiations is the cost of public safety retirement. The Harbor Patrol started paying 3% of the employee portion of our retirement during the last contract for our part as furlough. In December 2013, at the end of our contract, the rest of the city's bargaining units stopped their furlough obligations, and the Harbor Patrol continued to pay the 3% ongoing. We are willing to work with the city in regards to their concerns about pension and retirement issues if the city is willing to work with us. When the Harbor Patrol negotiated safety retirement, they gave up salary increases for almost 5 years. And now the city is asking not only to give up this benefit, but are not offering the same salary increases that have been offered to the rest of the TAP unit. Excuse me, a little dry mouth. Throughout this negotiation process, we have been told that the major reasons for having to pay for PERS and not receiving salary increases is because it had to be fair to the other units within the city. This seemed very odd to me because during the previous two negotiations that I negotiated with the city, when the Harbor Patrol, that I negotiated for the Harbor Patrol, the other safety units within the city received higher compensation packages than the Harbor Patrol. When we asked to get the same benefit, I was told that they were different bargaining units and were negotiated differently. Now, when the Harbor Patrol is asking for certain benefits, the city has said no because that would not be fair to the other units. What's fair is to recognize the concessions that the Harbor Patrol has already made. All I'm asking for today is a fair and equitable contract that I can bring back to the rest of the Harbor Patrol. Thank you.
Thank you. Ryan Kelly, and then Carl Halamicket. Mr. You're going to have to help me with that. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Kelly, you have 2 minutes.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, and council members. Good afternoon. My name is Ryan Kelly. I've been a Harbor Patrol officer with the City of Santa Barbara for 8 years, and I'm here to ask for your support for our pending contract. We are one of three public safety units in the city, along with police and fire, and I feel we are oftentimes overlooked because of the size of our department. Our division consists of 10 officers responsible for law enforcement, firefighting, ocean rescue, and overall water safety in and around the Harbor District. I'm here today, along with my fellow officers, to ask you for your consideration in approving a fair contract for the TAP unit and the men and women of the Santa Barbara Harbor Patrol. Thank you for your time.
Let's try again. Halamicek, maybe? Okay. You'll correct me when you get up here, followed by Thomas Welchy.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and Council. My name is Carl Halamicek, and I am a Harbor Patrol officer, and I've been with the city for 4 years. Like most peace officers, I've chosen this line of work because of the excitement, demanding challenges, and the responsibility of keeping people safe. As you may know, Harbor Patrol is a 24-hour emergency response agency that provides law enforcement, emergency marine, fire, medical, and ocean and landside response services to help keep the waterfront area safe and orderly. Harbor Patrol is a diverse and highly skilled department. We are peace officers, licensed boat captains, emergency medical technicians, marine firefighters, and certified lifeguards. We often work out of the view of the general populace on the ocean, where our activities go largely unnoticed. Our work goes far beyond driving boats around the harbor. We respond to offshore boating emergencies and inclement weather, making vessel stops and boarding vessels, work closely with the homeless community, and respond to a variety of medical emergencies within our jurisdiction. These are just a few of the things we do as Harbor Patrol officers. During this negotiation process, I've been told not to compare ourselves with the other public safety units because we are different. Sure, we may have differences in our job duties and our bargaining units may not be the same. But when it comes down to it, our mission is not, no different than the other two public safety units. We are the men and women people call on in time of need. The work we do at times is dangerous, stressful, and has the potential to be fatal, regardless whether it's on land or water. As we move forward, I'm asking your support in a fair contract for Harbor Patrol. If you have questions regarding Harbor Patrol or our operations, we are open to discussing them at a future council meeting if you wish. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Welch, be followed by Jason Guy. Good afternoon.
Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. My name is Thomas Welch. I've been with the city almost 9 years as an operator at the El Estero Wastewater Treatment Plant. I'm also the chairperson of the TAP Bargaining Unit and a member of the SEIU Local 620 Board of Directors. My bargaining unit is a diverse one that supplies this wonderful city with some of its most essential health and safety services. I stand before you with mixed feelings, especially after seeing you present some excellent employees with their service awards today. I'm here representing over 100 employees, many of whom do not feel recognized for their service. We have been at the negotiating table for over 9 months and are frustrated that we are not being heard by the city. So we're here today so that we hope you can hear us today. This is only my second time at the bargaining table. The first being in the depth of the 2010 economic crisis. And I can say without a doubt that the table back then was by far more cooperative, more understanding, and more productive than the table has been at this time around. In our last negotiations, we were able to work with the city, work cooperatively to find cost-saving measures that would work for the very different operations around the city that my unit represents. This time around, I feel like the contributions we made during that difficult time have been forgotten and dismissed. And under the guise of fairness, we have been presented proposals that do not take into account the specific characteristics of our bargaining unit and are merely trying to lump us in with other bargaining units, general, PD, for example. Local 620 and the TAP bargaining team have been negotiating in good faith throughout this process. This is something that, in my opinion, I can't say is true with the city's negotiating team, especially with this last example of being denied fact-finding. I understand a legal deadline's been passed, but I'm also aware that it's almost an industry standard to allow extensions for this process to go through. I don't know the motives behind denying the process, and I hope the city would like to present their documents for further review so that we can continue to work and move forward. My team and I feel that there's more work to be done and we would like the opportunity to continue this process. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wells. Jason Guy will be followed by Clint Orr.
Greetings, good afternoon, Mayor, City Council. I'm here to ask you to listen and listen carefully. I'm one of the control system operator specialists at the water treatment plant. I've been there for almost 7 years. In those 7 years, I've seen major turnover of the workforce, been through three major fires, battled with meeting new state regulations, scrutinized by the public for our wages and pensions, been furloughed because we shared the pain, major construction upgrades, drought conditions, and now struggling to get a new contract being at impasse. To say the least, the last 7 years have been extremely stressful and disheartening. We at Cato are the new generation. We are the young, educated workforce, not the generation that you knew before that lived high on the hog, that had the good old days. Most of us are college educated. Some of us are veterans, like myself. And many of us are new husbands and fathers. We have gone through some major changes at Cato in the way we treat water and to stay in compliance. We have gone through a ringer in construction of the Ortega Water Treatment Plant and upgrades at Cato, and 3 years of our workspace being invaded by every contractor and engineer who thinks they know best. Our work days and routines have been disrupted as well. During the fires, we stayed strong. We kept the plant working so our firefighters could keep battling the blazes. If you remember, the Hayseseeta fire burned through our plant, destroying property, changing our schedules, yet we were there all through the night, and even the next day, putting out fires with garden hoses and shovels. During the downturn of the economic downturn of the country, we faced public scrutiny about our salary and pensions. We took a hit. We shared the pain. When furloughs were needed, we helped save jobs in the city. We gave up our time and money when you needed it most. We are facing a very serious drought. Every day we deal with ever-changing water quality that comes into the plant and ever-increasing demand for alternative water sources. We feel that the drought is being cost against us. We did not cause this drought. Our workload has been doubled, and we've been stretched very thin. No new operators have been added to our staff, and also we've had the luxury of a few OITs working at a minimum cost. We now face the biggest concern, which is whether or not we can come to an agreement with you over a new contract that is fair. Our paychecks keep getting smaller and smaller. The health care control is out of control, health care cost, and we all want to switch to an HSA to save money for the city, but you won't contribute to our health. Oh, and one thing I didn't mention was during all this, we've kept the water running. It saddens me to know that some of you, elected officials and leaders, don't really care about us. And as I speak now, it's probably falling on some stubborn and some deaf ears. This is it. It's the fourth quarter. It's 2 minutes to go. And if we don't have the leadership or support of our elected officials, then we'll see a very special team of trained and certified operators fail.
You need to wind up, please.
If you don't care about us, then why should we care about you? We have always been there for you. You should trust that the water comes out of the tap is safe for you to drink. You can open your mouth in the shower. You can wash your dishes and clothes. And probably most importantly, you can flush your toilets.
Thank you. Your time is up.
Thank you.
Clint Orr will be followed by Phil Walker.
Well, and Mayor Schneider, council members, I'm Clint Orr. On an entirely different subject, I'd like to thank you for putting up with me over the last 9 months or so as I've been chatting with you about opening a community dance hall at the Shuttered Elephant Bar. It appears that I've got the paperwork and financial arrangements done and hope to close the deal as best we can. I mean, as far as we still have to do a lot of repairs and a lot of tenant improvements in September. So I hope to open possibly in December during the holidays, as opposed to in February, March, and in the drizzle and so forth that we hopefully get. It'd be nice to open in the holidays. This would be the single most important achievement of my life, and it'll be an honor after 20 years of efforts to open it here in your community. Thanks.
Phil Walker will be followed by Scott Wentz.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. The gentleman that spoke from Cato Water Treatment Plant is speaking from a much shallower perspective than I have at El Estero. But personally speaking, from almost 33 years of experience, this gentleman that spoke before me, it was like me a long time ago. And, you know, you're thought of as an operator, but you're also a jack of all trades, and you have to deal with responding to situations in a real-time basis. And all these people I'm looking at here are very, very invaluable to the city, to the public, and they do a great job, and I think they're well rewarded with a reasonable, honest contract. So it's time to get it ratified and settled. One other quick thing, I'm going to divert to water again. Water that comes out of nowhere can do tremendous damage just in the last couple days in the San Gabriel Mountains, Mount Baldy area, and Forest Falls. The water came from nowhere, and there's a number of structures red tagged now. Okay, the Kosicki Bridge, it was the March 10th, 1995, Sycamore over Creek overtopped during the floods, and that's been almost 20 years that the existing footbridge was just put on in a temporary status, and it became permanent, like things a lot of times do. But I talked to a couple of gentlemen that were taking a breather down there, and they confirmed the fact it was 1995, March 10th. And Public Works Department had to destroy the existing bridge essentially to prevent further damage downstream when it was blocked up by uke logs. So that's what happened. But a lady was coming across when I was talking to these two gentlemen pushing a walker supported by it. And the decking on that particular little footbridge is lifting up, and it's getting in real poor state and needs some attention. And,
thank you.
Thank you.
Scott Wentz will be followed by Wanda Livernoy.
Madam Mayor, members of the council, Scott Wins representing Carser Basic. In the past, we've asked very serious questions about the veracity of city transportation staff. We've brought to you documentation proving that they have misled and intentionally deceived, in many instances, both the city council and the people. As a result, we've been going around asking questions. Well, a legal type person got in my ear the other day and said, have you ever asked that question legally of all three branches of the city? So that's what I'm here to do. I've prepared a letter that it was addressed to the city administrator, to the legislative, and to the legal section of the city of Santa Barbara. Under whose written authority did these actions occur? Under whose verbal authority did these actions occur? We want that answer. And we would request that you provide that information by the 18th of August. If the city cannot provide a response to that after the 18th of August, we will make the assumption that the city of Santa Barbara concurs with us that this has happened, and we'll be feel free to produce any ads, information, or informational seminars stating that the city of Santa Barbara has, in fact, misappropriated the information to the citizens. Thank you.
Wanda Livernoy, be followed by Jose Arturo Ortiz de Martinez Gallegos.
Good afternoon. I'm Wanda Livernoy, 533 Brinkerhoff. And I'm very concerned about Mission Creek, and I don't know who to contact. If you are on Coda or Ortega at Mission Creek, there's just a tremendous amount of vegetation in the creek bed. And I'm wondering if county flood control is the entity I should get to, or the city. I need to know that. That's number one. Number two, I know a variety of people are very interested in mixed use, and I would like all of you to not only drive by 720 De La Vina, but stop and take a look at it. Because if that's it, it's not it. Think of the person who is living in 726 De La Vina. The ventilation is going to be terrible in that place. Take a look at it. If that's what we're doing, it's not it. Okay? And who do I go to? Do I go to county?
Mr. Pat Kelly's in the back of the room. That's the best place to start about Mission Creek.
Okay, good.
He's waving. Yeah, he's right in the back. Okay, there we go. Ask and you shall receive sometimes, right? Okay. All right, we have a number of people who want to waive their time for Mr. Martinez de Gallegos. And is David Keith here? David Keith? No? Okay. Aurelio Bocanegra, you're here. Great. Michael Marinda, there you are, Michael. And Carolyn Clancy. Okay, so you have up to 8 minutes.
Good afternoon, Mayor, Council members. I just want to thank the council members for not approving the emergency homeless shelters that took place 2 weeks ago. I really appreciate it, and for the privilege to let me speak. I wish to address to City Council Member Murillo on her comments on July 22nd, 2014, about the drug and alcohol programs that she stated that they do good work here in Santa Barbara. City Council Murillo, I felt that you dismissed my experience as a homeless individual and my intelligence on my comments on why drug and alcohol rehabs do not work. And it is the drug addicts and the alcoholics who get into housing first before those with disabilities and senior citizens with disabilities. It is a revolving door with the drug addicts and alcoholics. And do you know why it is a revolving door with drug addicts and alcoholics? Well, I do, as so many others who are not addicted to drugs or alcohol. Because the nonprofits and agencies, the enablers, make money on those who are addicted to drugs and alcohol. They receive state and federal funds. They are wasting taxpayers' money. There is no money to be made on those who have disabilities, senior citizens with disabilities, who are not drug addicts or alcoholics. They have a 7 to 10 year wait to get into housing. Those who are addicted to drugs and alcohol that go through rehab programs and presumably that they are clean and sober get fast-tracked into housing within 18 months. Many of the caseworkers, counselors, social workers who work in drug and alcohol rehab, they themselves have a drug and alcohol dependence. I have seen it. They are supposed to be recovered addicts, and the majority are not. That is why they are in the business, and that is common knowledge. They fail as well. If drug and alcohol rehabilitation works so well, why is it that so many who reside at the Faulding Hotel, who are supposed to be clean and sober, still do drugs and alcohol? Whether it be inside or outside of the Faulding Hotel, everyone knows it except for you. Last year, a woman who was severely disabled was raped by approximately 9 men at the Faulding Hotel. For some reason, she was evicted. And these men who committed this atrocity still reside at the Faulding Hotel. Also, there was a gang rape that took place sometime back at the Hotel de Riviera that was reported to the police. This is the sort of thing that happens all the time with a drug and alcohol population. Sexual abuse happens more often than what you think. Many of these cases are never reported because of fear of losing housing or never getting housing. The perpetrators are both male and female. This abuse is not only sexual. There is also psychological, physical abuse. These abuses create enormous costs and financial burden to the taxpayers. The reason why you do not hear about these abuses is because the nonprofits and government agencies are in collusion. Why is it that the police are always being called at the El Carrillo apartments, the Artisan Court apartments, and the Faulding Hotel? Because of the residents who are addicts are doing, selling drugs, drinking alcohol heavily, shoplifting at the various stores, and in violation of parole. Low-income housing. Wow. Drug addicts and alcoholics do need the help. However, they are not getting the help they need. And they will never get the help they need. And this is due to the high cost of living in Santa Barbara. Qualified health care providers for drugs and alcohol recovery cannot afford the high cost of living in Santa Barbara. The system in Santa Barbara discriminates against senior citizens, the disabled, and the working class, and the working poor. There is money to be made on the revolving door of drug and alcohol programs. These are the facts. Penn and Teller reported on their program that aired on Showtime. They received a copy of a one-year survey by Alcoholics Anonymous headquarters done in 1989. This survey showed a rehab success rate of 5%. This 5% is the same success rate without rehab. In the year 2000, Dr. Nancy Snyderman for an ABC News 2020 special contacted AA headquarters and was told the success rate for rehab recovery is less than 3%. That was for the year of 2000. In the year 2009, a federally funded national survey determined that this success rate for rehab and recovery is less than 1% in the United States. In Europe, it is a 75% success rate. With all due respect, City Council Member Murillo, if Casa Esperanza, Rescue Mission, and Salvation Army does such good work on their drug and alcohol rehab, then why is it that the Kroc Foundation would not allow one penny of the $1.8 billion endowment to existing Salvation Army rehab recovery programs? This funding may only be used for seniors, disabled, and children. This is why the Santa Barbara Salvation Army does not have access to the funding of the Kroc Foundation. With all due respect, Council Member Murillo, you speak of all the good work that the shelters and rehab centers accomplish. Do you know something that the Kroc Foundation does not know? All of you have been lied to, conned, and bamboozled. All the crimes that I mentioned are state and federal violations of the American Disabilities Act. If the Department of Justice is not here by the end of this year to investigate these heinous crimes, they will be here sometime next year to do a thorough investigation. Thank you for your time.
Shella Dumong will be followed by Valenka Castaneda.
Hi, good afternoon. Madam Mayor and Council Members, my name is Shella Dumong, and I am the Executive Director of a local nonprofit agency called Chance Housing. And we help our community members born with cognitive, intellectual, and developmental disabilities with their affordable and accessible housing needs. I'm a little bit nervous, sorry. I just want to make sure that the City Council knows that our local community members with disabilities are having a really terrible time accessing our local affordable housing resources, rent subsidies, housing units. The people that our agency represents are people with Down syndrome, cerebral palsy, autism, epilepsy, and those kinds of conditions. I've heard a long, I got a little bit disconnected after listening to that last long piece of testimony, but our folks are having a really difficult time, and I just want to make sure that you know that if our community members are not involved with drug and alcohol services, are not abusers, then they're not accessing housing, and it's quite difficult. I hope that the City Council will consider reshuffling its priorities, refocusing its priorities on the population of people who live here who have acquired their disabilities through no reason of their own actions, but really simply because of the caprices of nature, and make sure that we have equal access to the resources that exist.
Thank you. Valenka, I think. Castaneda will be followed by Cindy Gonzalez.
Good afternoon. My name is Valeska Castaneda. I'm the founder of A Trail for Humanity, which is a more than 370-mile walk that launched on July 22nd, organized by mothers at the University of California, Berkeley, to raise awareness about the policies and geopolicies abroad. When we launched, we had heard about the gang injunction that had been stopped here in Santa Barbara. which was very moving, especially since we are looking to raise awareness throughout the 41 cities about policies impacting documented, undocumented, and migrant communities. But as we reached our 14th day and our 214-mile mark here today, we heard news that the gang injunction decision is being appealed. So I'm here asking.
I'm going to interrupt you now if this, because we have a closed session item.
I realize that, but we have just finished walking 214 miles with mothers and children.
I'm going to let you.
And this is our halfway point. So I'm going to ask you to please allow us to finish, just as other senators and council members have allowed us to as well.
Let me finish my statement, which is the way the rules work is public comment is for items not on the agenda. You're most welcome to give your public comment to the item when it comes up onto the agenda. Okay, so if this is all about the upcoming closed session, you're more than welcome to speak on the item when that item comes up. Okay? Mm-hmm. So I will hold on to your public comment speaker slips. Okay. I will hold on to your public comment speaker slips, and when we call for that item before we go into closed session on the item, we'll make sure you all have an opportunity to speak. We just do this with everyone on
That's
every
perfectly
item.
Fine.
Okay? So I'll
Thank
let you,
you
start
so.
Over your 2 minutes at that point. Thank
That's
you.
Fine. So start there. Then
yep, I'll hold on to these until we get there. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. So that concludes the public comment. Actually, there's one more not on that item. Chris Benedict will be the final public comment speaker.
Hello, Council. How are you today? I'm here to talk about about the housing. The city needs more accessible housing, and we need to have better access to local housing resources like rental units, rent subsidies, and to participate in federal housing programs. All of these resources are going to homeless, subsidies, and substance abusers.
Thank you.
And, about 7 years ago, I was in a real bad roommate situation, and it took me 5 years to get out of that verbal abusive relationship. Now, if I was able-bodied, I would have been able to pack up and move. But since I am in a wheelchair, I would have to have special accommodations. And it took me 5 long years to find anything. And finally, I found something at Pilgrim Terrace that is very good. But that being said, the 5 years took a long time to come. So if we can get the more accessible housing in the city, that would be great. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So that concludes public comment. We move on to the consent calendar. We have an item or two to read.
Item 2, introduction of ordinance for an amendment to lease agreement number 23564 with Conway Vineyards Incorporated, recommending that council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara approving Amendment 1 to lease agreement number 23564 with Conway Vineyards Incorporated at an average initial base rent of $4,302.02 per month, allocated seasonally, or 10% of gross sales, whichever is greater, effective October 9, 2014, and continuing for the remainder of the lease term of 5 years with 2 5-year extension options.
Thank you. Without further objection, we'll waive further reading. We do have a public comment slip for item number 10. Are there any other items?
Item number 11.
Item 11. Mayor. Any others? Okay. If you could, item 16. You read item 10, please.
Contract for final design of the Las Positas Road at Cliff Drive Roundabout Project.
Thank you, Mr. Wentz.
First off, your staff has given you an alternative design. That alternative design is $600,000. This design is $1.6 million, and this organization has taken a look at it and said, it's not even going to come close. It's probably going to be closer to $2 million when you finally put in all the added items associated with it. Secondly, this is a dead-end road, which means that the traffic pattern in the morning is one direction, and the traffic pattern in the afternoon is another direction. So, I mean, what's the problem here? Staff has already pointed out that they can fix the problem. Thirdly, you have an issue of CEQA. Digging up an intersection, remediating the asphalt, putting in a new intersection, pouring the cement, all has an impact upon the environment. This is really, really bad planning. It's bad use of taxpayer money. I urge you, to every one of you, to vote against this because of the expense and the environmental impact. And I will end this comment and hope that you will be polled individually on this item. This is a staff, the City of Santa Barbara staff comment regarding another project that was within a quarter of a mile from here. Under CEQA, the city must identify feasible alternatives that will avoid or at least lessen any significant impacts associated with the project. Well, your staff project and CAB's project meets that definition. Therefore, you'll be in violation of CEQA, according to your own staff.
Okay. Mr. White?
I apologize. I would appreciate a chance to comment on item 12 as well.
Oh, okay. Okay. Does anyone else have any comments on item 10? No. Okay. Yes. Like you want to vote separately? So is there a motion for item 10?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, that's 6-1. Thank you. Item 11, if you could read item 11.
Contract for development of city's 5-year consolidated plan.
Thank you, Mr. Hart.
Madam Mayor, I just ask that this be taken off in light of some of the public comment we had earlier in support of the need for additional funding for affordable housing. This is a contract to develop a 5-year consolidated plan to identify strategies the city's going to use to assist in the development of affordable housing. And I thought it was appropriate to reference the recent state legislative efforts in Sacramento to approve the cap and trade program. There are significant new funding available for affordable housing. This is going to be, it's certainly nothing on the scale that we enjoyed with the redevelopment agency and the affordable housing set aside, but it is a significant step. There's about $130 million statewide in this upcoming budget year, specifically for affordable housing, more than $200 million in subsequent years. And I think the experience that we have with the housing authority, the city staff, developing really successful, effective, affordable housing programs will put us in good position to compete for those dollars statewide.
Thank you. Any other comments on that item? Okay. Item 12, if you could read item 12.
Assistance to firefighters 2013 grant funds for breathing apparatus.
Thank you, Mr. White.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I just want to give a shout out to our fire department staff, Ron Lichty in particular, and Mike DuPonce for leading this grant application process. It's a major boon to our department and to our city, and thank you for making that added effort, and we all will benefit from that. So.
Great. Actually, a question, Mr. Armstrong, on this item. I believe when we had the one-time capital workshop, we included this as part of the monies. So if this is now grant funds going to replace those funds, or what happens with
that.
Actually, it was included in the just in the general fund capital improvement program, and so we will be coming back to the council with some alternative options on the use of those funds. Okay. But this will allow us to then extend those monies to another purpose.
Okay, great. Great. Okay, and then item number 16, if you could read that.
Library Plaza Renovation Final Design Services Contract.
Thank you, Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I pulled this. I don't need to vote on this separately, but I'd like to give an opportunity for Director Macias to walk us through the changes in the library plan, where we are today, and what it's going to encompass.
Ms. Macias.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of the council. I'm Irene Macias, Library Director. The initial concept for the Library Plaza renovation was to include only the Library Plaza, which is at the front part of the library on Anacapa Street. About a year ago, we had conversations with the Santa Barbara Museum of Art, and they indicated that they were going to move forward with a major renovation plan, and we saw some opportunities to coordinate and certainly to accommodate some of the requests from the art museum. So at that time, we made the decision to enlarge the scope of the project to include the entire library parcel. Some of the changes to that, and actually during our public process, even though the scope wasn't that expansive yet, the public did indicate the strong desire to have ADA access on the south side of the library, which is currently a staircase. And so one of the major accomplishments of adding the entire parcel is to make the entire parcel universally accessible. That means the plaza on the back end of the library between the museum and the library. It means the path of travel from the parking structure to the library, to the museum, to La Arcata. The sidewalk along Library Avenue, which is the entrance to the parking structure, will also be widened by a couple of feet. So there are many added enhancements to the project since it was first conceived. And the project estimate is really the upper end of what it could be. Part of the final design process is to get an estimate for the construction costs. So some of the elements that might impact the costs are any artistic elements that we would include, any recommended finishes by the Historic Landmarks Commission for types of paving or fancier lighting that might be required. Also, there is the possibility that there might be unforeseen conditions when we begin to tear up the plaza. So we just tried to account for any of those probabilities.
Okay, thank you. With that, is there a motion for the balance of the consent calendar?
So moved, Madam Mayor.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Great. Okay, on to item number 22.
Introduction of ordinance for purchase and sale agreement for sale of land located at 6100 Hollister Avenue, recommending that council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only an ordinance of the council of the city of Santa Barbara approving and authorizing the city administrator to execute the purchase and sale agreement and related agreements between the city of Santa Barbara and Direct Relief, a California nonprofit public benefit corporation, at a base price of $25 per square foot of land area.
Thank you, Ms. Johns.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and Council. Hazel Johns, Airport Department, and I will be doing the presentation on the sale agreement, purchase and sale agreement.
Yes, it is.
Is it on? Closer? Okay. Better? Okay, thanks. The report today will cover the background on Direct Relief and their need for a new facility. We'll look at the land and the location, history of the development attempts over the years, including the airport's investigation of developing than DRI's offer and the terms of the purchase, along with a report on the consolidation or consultation with the FAA. As you know, Direct Relief was founded in Santa Barbara in 1948 as a nonprofit humanitarian health organization. They are the only nonprofit accredited and licensed nonprofit to distribute prescription medication in all 50 states. They also serve as a critical resource in disasters and emergency situations. DRI has a staff of 57 employees and is complemented with volunteers on a daily basis. DRI owns the facility located at 27 South La Patera Lane and also leases space in a warehouse across the street in order to accommodate their current and future activities and to meet increased security requirements. DRI began searching for a new location that could meet their building requirements of 100,000 square feet for warehouse and 25,000 square feet of office space. Although DRI looked at various locations on the Central Coast, they wished to remain in the area and approach the city regarding the vacant land at the airport. The 15-acre parcel at 6100 Hollister Avenue was identified in the airport-specific plan for new development. It is zoned appropriately for commercial and industrial use and is not encumbered with FAA aviation use restrictions. This aerial gives you a perspective. The green circle at the top is the current location of DRI, and the red square is the land parcel we're discussing. It's bordered on the south by Hollister Avenue, on the east by Lopez, the north Botello Road, and on the west, that's David Love Place. The 15 acres has a long history, more than 17 years of development attempts. The airport conducted two lengthy requests for proposals for a single operator. We worked with a developer on a condo ownership concept, responded to a local utility company for a service and storage facility, a hotel expressed interest, and of course the Target project has been presented about four times. And most recently, Deckers considered developing their corporate campus on this land. While there were many issues in each of the proposals, a major limiting factor of developing is the city charter's lease restriction of 50 years. Currently, there are no land entitlements on the parcel. Based on the unsuccessful commercial developments, council directed airport staff to pursue the small parcel development for industrial commercial tenants consistent with the approved specific plan. A small building with expansion opportunities has been the niche for the airport. We retain services of an architect to develop a site plan and to look at a feasible concept for industrial buildings. This exhibit provides one of the concepts that the airport developed for this parcel. It includes 13 lots with building sizes between 6 and 15,000 square feet for a total of 142,000 square feet on the parcel. We also contacted the stakeholders surrounding the airport for input on the idea of the airport developing the land and received strong support, especially in view of the fact that there has not been any new small commercial industrial development of this type in more than 25 years. However, when we prepared the pro forma, it was obvious that by using outside financing, the airport would have a debt service requirement for 35 to 40 years, and that the return on the investment would not be substantial until the last 10 years of a 50-year period, thus making this concept too high risk. When DRI first approached the city to discuss vacant land at the airport, we proposed a 50-year term lease. However, since DRI will be raising funds to develop, a long-term lease would not work. DRI proposed to purchase 6 to 8.5 acres and has targeted occupancy for 2016. This exhibit reflects the 15-acre parcel with a little over 6 acres plotted there in the northeast corner. Should DRI require the full 8.5 acres, the plot would expand to cover most of the northern section of the parcel. A roadway would separate the two areas. The negotiated terms of the sale established a base price per square foot of $25. This amount will be appraised 90 days prior to the close of escrow so that we can maintain FAA's requirement for fair market value, and it needs to be current. The increase in the purchase price, however, does have no more than a 10% cap. The deposit is non-refundable if DRI waives the termination rights and walks away, but it is refundable if they give notice of termination or if the city defaults in any of its requirements. DRI will have 18 months for due diligence, including obtaining entitlements, and this period can be extended for an additional 6 months. At the end of the feasibility period, escrow will close within 90 days. During this period, the airport will continue to lease the land and buildings on a month-to-month basis, generating revenue for the airport. There's also a right of first offer agreement offering the city the first right to purchase the land back should DRI elect to sell the land. The purchase price will be appraised, but the city would have the option to buy it at 10% less market value. This reduction begins to decrease in year 21 at 1% per year until the discount is eliminated. Another exhibit of the agreement provides that DRI will make annual community support payments in lieu of real property tax to the city. DRI will design, construct, and install a roadway separating its lot from the balance of the parcel. The city will reimburse DRI 50% of the cost of the road upon the completion of the first building constructed on the remaining land. FAA has been consulted, and inasmuch as the aviation use restriction on the land was removed in 1984, FAA concurs the land can be sold at fair market value, and the proceeds must be used for the operation, maintenance, and capital improvement of the airport. This agreement is categorically exempt from environmental review, but it will require an allocation of the growth management square footage. This land sale meets the needs of a strong local humanitarian nonprofit, and the proceeds will allow the airport to begin its own commercial industrial development. This concept exhibit illustrates the possible joint development of the 15 acres. That concludes my report. I'm available for questions, and in the audience we have Thomas Teague, the president of DRI, and also John Romo, their board chair.
Thank you. Any questions? I see, Mr. Teague, you have your speaker slip. Are you, if you'd like to speak at this point, or are you just here for questions? Either way. Go out, come on up. I don't see any lights on up here, so welcome.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and members of the council. I am here in support of the proposed transaction and wanted to thank all the city staff members. It's been a long effort, and we keenly appreciate the sensitivities of dealing with public land. We're a public benefit corporation. We have no financial commercial interest to, which we understand would bring it into a different realm. We drive by that parcel every day going to work and see that it's not used. And just our circumstances as one of, there's 500 distribution centers in this country through which prescription medications can be provided. There's one that's a nonprofit, and it's us, and it happens to be here. So as we would like to continue and to fulfill this role and address the gaps that obviously exist, the public, the pressure on the public funds, to make sure that the philanthropic efforts to address these gaps are done as well as efficiently as possible, using the commercial tools and practices of what we've been doing for 65 years, it seemed like a perfect match, just being in the neighborhood. We're stretched out across the street, which is not optimal, and just to make sure that we continue to fulfill a role, both for local residents as a backup to the county, to the state, for which we receive no public money. The proposal is to, this is a private, these are private funds. We're not asking for money. Your negotiators offered a total of zero concessions over the entire period that we talked about it, much as we would love have loved to, we understand that. So we're very excited about the opportunity, are proud of our local resident status and want to make sure and understand that it has to work for the local community as well as our fiduciary responsibilities as a public benefit corporation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Did you have a question? Mr. Hotchkiss has a question for you.
Oh, thank you very much for coming forward. What are the prospects of your fundraising campaign? How long do you expect to take, et cetera? You want to talk a little bit about that? Because we've got the public watching you now.
Yes. Well, we're in a strong financial situation as an organization. I'm joined here by our current chairman, John Romo, and our former chairman, Stan Hatch, who would choke me if I said anything about our prospects. But we are confident with a $34 million endowment that's unrestricted right now. Having come off a fiscal year where we raised $19.2 million in cash and increased public visibility and really fulfilling a role that's unique both in this country and internationally, that it's a very strong case to be made. Although this is a public hearing, this is our quiet phase of the, were this to be concluded, we would then launch a careful campaign to raise the funds, but we're confident based on the merits of what we're proposing to do that the support is there, and particularly to keep us local in a place that people can understand the logic of. So I'm very hopeful, and I think the momentum is strong, and the case is a very good one. Is that responsive? Thank you.
Did you also have a question? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I also want to acknowledge that Goleta Mayor Michael Bennett is in the room observing as well, so welcome. So Mr. Hart.
Whoops. I just want to say that I was struck reading the staff report how many times the phrase unprecedented was used in talking about the sale of airport land. And I got to tell you that I sort of struggled with that issue as well when we were talking about these negotiations behind closed doors. But I think at the end of the day, I'm struck, too, by the staff report's reference to Direct Relief as being a unique organization. And that is why I can support this, because this is truly an exceptional circumstances, an outstanding organization. We're very, very proud to have you as part of the community. Want you to stay and understand that this is really critical to that reality. And so I personally am supportive of this. I think this is the right thing to do at the right time. It is a hard thing for, I think, us as stewards of public property, you know, for the future. This is our job to be very careful with this, these kind of resources. But this is a unique circumstance. So I could support this, and I would move the staff recommendation.
There's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Mr. Rouse.
Just a quick question for Ms. Johns. On the comment under environmental review, we talked about the growth management square footage requirement. Would you elaborate on that, please?
Mayor Schneider and Councilman Rouse, the total square footage of 125,000 square feet, the airport has square footage that we that would go with that parcel, but we don't have the total of 125. So there would be a combination, I would think, once we go through development review to allocate additional square footage for the proposal. That's it.
Okay, thank you. I might have been thinking about the former Measure E.
Yes.
Is that what we're talking about?
Yes.
So this will count against the total for the
Measure E. As far as I understand it.
Mr. Armstrong?
I'm not quite sure how we're. I mean, when we reviewed this, the airport's got the allocation already for this property. We may have to come back, but under the new general plan, I think we'll be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Dwight.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I think that I probably have been the one of the most skeptical people about the principle of selling land out of the airport. It's something that goes just counter to my grain, and obviously to a lot of the background of the airport's use of property in general. And so dragging me along on, I'm probably the deepest skid marks on dragging this council along are being created by me. And I would ask this, put this ask out there. to make your footprint, there's a range that you're proposing in your acreage. And I would ask that those skid marks getting to yes include you doing your very best to take as little land as possible for your footprint. That would be I'm getting nods from you. I'm gonna have that be that yes, you'll make the best effort to have as small a footprint as possible, even if it, in the long term it might even include a parking structure that puts a couple of stories of parking for your next phase of development and such like. Anything you can do to keep your footprint compact, that's what I would appreciate you looking at. That's what what you're getting out of that then is a unanimous council approval with the skid marks behind. Thank you. And DRI is my favorite international nonprofit, so I'm really had to struggle with this.
Mr. Francisco.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Direct Relief International is an unusual organization with a long history in this community and in the world. And when I looked at this, my feeling was their role here in the community is so incredibly, potentially important in the case of a natural disaster or other disaster in our own backyards. That's obviously not the only consideration, but DRI is a very unusual nonprofit, and their situation there at the airport needs to be resolved. So I have no problem in this case supporting the sale of city property for what I'm absolutely positive is the highest and best use of that property.
I too want to thank for your decades-long work throughout the world and right here at home in so many incredible ways. And I think you were listed as one of the best fiscally run nonprofits in the country by someone important, Fortune 500 or someone like that. And so, you know, your track record is impeccable. To me, it's all the things that have been said about why this seems to make sense, even though it's an unusual request and process, it's not only because to keep you in a place where you need to be for your future, meeting your future mission and goals, but also a long-time goal of the city in trying to figure out how to finance and create additional industrial use buildings. We hear time and again, this is the kind of thing that we need on the South Coast. And looking at the South Coast as a region for economic development, UCSB just right next door practically, the Goleta Entrepreneur Magnet Gem, which is nearby, this I think could be a real boost to the entrepreneurship and the spirit of that and the opportunities for people to stay in Santa Barbara when they have a great idea and want to launch it right here. And this might be the way that we can finally finance something after 20 years of, you know, test and fail and test and fail of getting to somewhere where we can reach that ultimate goal. So what a great combination there. So I appreciate the hard work and negotiations, and I too will be supporting the motion. So with that, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Great. Thank you very much, and thank you for being here. Okay, we have item number 23.
Stage 2 drought update.
It rained a little.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of council. It did rain a little. And I want to say everyone did a fantastic job cleaning up after the rain. I was worried about that when I saw all of the Fiesta celebration. Rebecca Bjork, Public Works Director, and to get here with me today is Joshua Hagmark, Acting Water Resources Manager, and Madeline Ward, our Water Conservation Coordinator. We are here again to present our monthly drought update to Council, giving you the status of where we are and an opportunity to talk about questions you may have, as well as what our plans are to continue to manage this evolving issue. Today's presentation will look over the water supply outlook, talk about our supplemental water purchases that we have secured and where we have opportunities. We want to update you on the status of the capital projects that we're implementing in order to respond to the drought. We would also like to highlight some of our conservation efforts. And finally, just address the issue of penalties. Very briefly, we still have more work to do in that area. So you've seen this numerous times now. For the benefit of people who may not have seen it, this chart represents our water supply planning matrix. Each year is October 1 to September 30th. And the bottom bar, the purple, is our recycled water, followed by Kachuma water, Kachuma carryover water, which is basically a savings account of water we work hard to develop, Gibraltar water, and then the green is state water, and the yellow is groundwater. We are currently nearing the end of year 3, 2014, and you can see that we are very dependent on local surface water supplies in the bottom three bars. We are also expecting to use much more state water than we would typically use, and I do want to point out that this is one of the benefits of being connected to the state supply, is that in times when our local supplies are diminished, we do have an opportunity that we would not otherwise have to bring imported water in. You can see our groundwater is a relatively small bar. As we've reported, we are having some equipment issues and trying to get that out, but we will continue to be producing groundwater. The good news is that means that we have more groundwater in storage for the following years. And then conservation is the red bar. We expect people to conserve all the time. Our community does a great job of that. We appreciate it. However, in times of drought, we really need to take extraordinary measures and do additional conservation. And later in the presentation, we will be talking about some of the conservation opportunities. I did want to talk a little bit about how we're doing versus how we had planned to be doing in this year. So this is a new chart. The first bar shows what we had planned in terms of how we would meet our water demand by supply. And then because we're only three quarters of the way through the year, the bars don't match. But when you move over to the planned year to date, you can see that we're actually very close to plan, with the only real variable being slightly more recycled water than we had planned on, very slightly, and more state water, imported water being used than what we had planned on. So that means that we have had less draw on our local surface water supplies and less draw on our groundwater supplies. So I think it's good news. It shows that our planning is working and that our supplies are coming through when we need them. And I hope it helps you understand where we are vis-a-vis where we are expecting to be. With that, I'd like to turn it over to Joshua, who's going to let you know where we are with regard to water conservation and our other issues.
Madam Mayor, Council Members, I am pleased to report that the community has achieved an 18% reduction for the month of July. Those are fresh off the press. Took a lot of work to get all those numbers together by this meeting early in August, but I think it's a time to celebrate. It's a time to look back on what we've done and what is working. I think a congratulations needs to go out to the community. We're on the right track. Last month, if you might remember, we had a 15% reduction in usage. So we are on the right path, whether it's the regulations, whether it's the rates that went into effect July 1, whether it's people's attitudes and towards working as a community, we are definitely on the right track. And as you can see here, I'm just walking through this chart, which we've discussed so many times before. We have the gray line here is the water year 2013, so looking back at our water use last year. It kind of bobs back and forth between water year 2014 planned, that is a normalized year. The difference between the two, there's a discussion going back and forth. For us, for this community, there's about a 3% difference between those two. But for all intents and purposes, we'll just show those for our discussion's sakes. And then our drought target, which is a 20% reduction below the normalized use. So that's the green line. And so we are on the right path. I think the message today is people need to continue to do what they're working on. If whatever it is, it's working. As we move through this drought, this is significantly going to help us meet the needs going forward if we can continue to sustain this type of conservation. So this is a new slide we've added to the discussion with the intent of being responsive to Council's comments last go-round, which is where are we with our target for this year? So this year's target was approximately 1,200 acre-feet, this blue line here. We were looking for about 1,200 acre-feet of savings in this water year, which ends with September 30th. We are currently at just shy of 500 acre feet of savings so far, and that includes July's, and we have two more months remaining. Within those 2 months of August and September, there's approximately 600 acre feet. So we're going to come really close if the community can keep the 20% target, keep close to the 20% target. We may fall short by 100 or so acre feet, but I think in the big picture, that's a huge success. In particular, looking at other communities out in California who are really struggling to meet some of these conservation goals, I think this community has quickly warmed up to it, and I'm very pleased with the direction that we're headed. Another comment that came out of the last drought update was a better understanding of how many users or customer connections were in each one of the categories. So these categories are based on our water utility billing. We have single-family residential, multifamily residential, commercial and industrial users, irrigation, commercial and parks, recreation. We have irrigation, recs, parks, and schools, and we have agricultural use. So within the single-family residential users, there are 16,900 connections within this 6,000 acre-feet of water that's annually used in this category. So that's a significant number of connections. We have the multifamily residential, that is, there's 6,400 users in this category. Under the commercial industrial, that is 600 connections in here. Oh, sorry, 2,700 connections within this category, I apologize. Under the irrigation, residential commercial, this is 600 connections in here. Agriculture is 60. And within the parks and rec, there are 150 service connections. Just giving an idea of the magnitude of number of connections that makes up this total number of water use. When you look at this, you can kind of the takeaway too is that approximately 50% of the water use in the city relies in the tier 2 and tier 3 area. The rates that went into effect in July were targeted to bring down the usage in these categories. So I think that's some of what we're seeing. Hopefully August we'll see even more conservation as people get their bills and kind of realize they got to bring it down some more.
We have a question, Mr. Hart.
So could you go back to that last slide?
Mm-hmm.
So if you were to do this by month and you would see the last 2 months that the red is shrinking, or is that not the case?
I at this point I have to go back and look, but I would guess it's actually coming from all tiers.
Really?
Okay. Yeah.
Interesting. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Since there was a question, so it rained very slightly, a little bit over the weekend, but for someone who wanted to irrigate their lawn and didn't, how long does that rain, like for, you know, if it, does that mean you don't have to even think about it for a couple of weeks or, you know, just to help people know what did that do for us over the weekend?
Madam Mayor, if we get 1 inch of rain, you don't need to irrigate for 2 weeks. I think we got a quarter of an inch. So anyone who's not irrigating, keep not irrigating. Maybe wait a week if you wanted to water. You probably got, based on where you were, you got a little bit of water. But we need really a solid inch to be able to delay that irrigation.
Great. That's good to know. And let it go brown anyway is the answer. Okay. Thanks. Please continue.
Supplemental water. Reporting back on this, the Vandenberg Air Force Base, we were able to secure about a little over 1,100 acre feet in extra water that they had available in San Luis Reservoir. We're currently under contract with Biggs West Gridley Water District to purchase 1,300 acre feet. That water is currently being delivered. And if there is no issues with the Delta, we expect to have all that water delivered by the end of September. The Mojave Water Agency, we are currently executing contracts with the Mojave Water Agency for 535 acre feet of water that they have available in San Luis Reservoir. That agreement is a mixture of outright purchased water and an unbalanced exchange where we would have to repay the water in future years. We have 10 years to repay that water. And then the last one is the banked water that we have in Dudley Ridge. It's a groundwater banking program, approximately 1,400 acre feet, and we're still working with them on the delivery of that, timing of that. So in total, we have about 4,410 acre feet of water that we feel pretty comfortable is in our supplemental water. Our projection through next year was the need for 4,500 acre-feet of water. So we're doing very good. We continue to work with CCWA, Central Coast Water Authority, to explore other options for purchasing water as well.
We have another question from Mr. Hart.
This is sort of on the slide that you just showed, I think, next. It's this capacity issue of getting the water from out of the area through the pipe that has a limited capacity. Not even 100% of that pipe is available to us, obviously, because we're sharing that with the other customers that get water through the state system. So are we getting to the point where we can't buy additional water for future water years because we have the pipe capacity is full with water that we bought this year?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hart, we are getting to that point. We've maximized the pipeline for this water year through October. Next year, they are allocating that. We do have, and I'm going to talk about that right here. We have about 3,000 acre feet that belongs to the city that we can import on an annual basis. However, if there is available capacity, other users aren't importing state water, there may be additional capacity available to us. So at this time, we are continuing to look for water. We're not letting this be a limiting factor. If there is an opportunity and a reasonable means of acquiring water, we're certainly looking to make.
Is there any reason to expect that one of our other partners in this system wouldn't take their capacity to buy state water?
Councilmember Hart, at this point, yes. At this point, their Goleta Water District mm-hmm. is not actively pursuing a significant amount of water. They're looking for about 900 acre feet. So there's a potential that there could be additional capacity. And Carpinteria, they don't have a significant state water allocation, but they're currently relying a lot on their wells as well, groundwater. Okay,
thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. White.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. In that regard, is it possible to lease that capacity at this stage? Is that something that's been discussed?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember White, what's interesting about it is if an agency is not using that portion of the pipeline, it automatically becomes available to the users. It isn't as long as they don't have it programmed out for water deliveries, then it automatically becomes open to the group for use.
But it can't be preempted or committed?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. Madam Mayor, Councilmember White, the Central Coast Water Authority regards the pipe as the property of the entity, and therefore, although we have allocated amounts, that's really for reasons of priority to make sure that we can get the amount of water that we are entitled to have, but they do not manage the pipe as straws in the pipe. They manage it as one pipe, and they have put together what I think works very effectively, that you are allocated your entitlement and then the rest is shared if it's not completely used. And that really gives us more capacity than if we started to divvy it up into little pieces.
So the answer to my question is no?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
And then just one last piece of that. So there's a decision point. I'm sorry, I didn't realize that you were finished. Excuse me.
And then on the Mojave unbalanced exchange, can we purchase water from elsewhere and have that go to, let's say, in future years, we owe them, was that 500 acre feet? Let's say 300. I mean, it's not a lot of water, but mm-hmm. Can that water be purchased elsewhere and then other capacity used to transfer that water to Mojave?
Councilmember White, that's correct. The idea with this is in a year where there's an abundance amount of water, we could either use our allocated state water to repay that, or we could purchase at a discounted price if there's a lot of water out there to fulfill that unbalanced exchange in future years.
Or an expensive price if it's not a opulent year.
Sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask, so there's a decision point at the beginning of the water year when the partners decide whether they're going to use their capacity or not, and then at that point it evolves to the cooperative use of that. So we will know before October whether Goleta is going to reserve capacity and whether we have the ability to purchase more water. Is that a revocable decision that they get to change in time?
The fun thing about water is everything seems to operate on different calendars. So the state water project decision will be made closer to the beginning of January. So we would have a better understanding of what how we can ask to have our water delivered at that point in time and whether there's excess capacity.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Hagmar, as this water is physically moved around, we have a total supplemental water of 4,410 acre feet. What is our anticipated actual yield? What kind of loss would we experience in all the transfer storage? And, you know, where does it physically go to before it's distributed to the meter users?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rouse, this water that we're talking about here, we would see very little losses in because basically it would move right through Kachuma. Basically, instantaneously, we wouldn't be storing it in Kachuma where we'd have evaporative losses. And the way that it is accounted for in San Luis Reservoir, there is no evaporative losses. That just is the accounting that they do for San Luis Reservoir. So the water is safe in San Luis Reservoir. There's no loss there. We take it. It moves through the pipeline. It basically moves instantaneously through Kachuma and into the South Coast conduit to us. So the losses on this should be negligible. Now, I do have to say, if we have Delta, any issues with the Delta, the Biggs West Gridley number could come down. That is a possible threat to that water source. But so far, there's no reason to believe there will be any issues with that going through September at this point.
Thank you. On that purchase, don't we purchase more water than that, and then that's the net? In other words, we're purchasing 2,000 acre feet, something like that, or 1,800 or 1,900, and that the Delta's getting a third or something like that. Isn't that ballpark?
Councilmember White, that's correct. We actually are purchasing 2,000 acre feet of water, and a portion of that is given to the environment in which the water is passed through. It's kind of a mitigation for making the transfer, and so we've given up approximately 700 acre feet to the Delta with the hopes of getting our 1,300 acre feet moved through there. So just quickly, you guys already asked all the great questions. There is infrastructure capability limits for supplemental water deliveries. The city's capacity is approximately 3,000 acre feet or 20% of our annual demand. And I do want to take the time because there is certainly this community has invested. There's a lot of money that's gone into the state water system, but I do think it's paying for itself. We aren't getting state water, but we're allowed to purchase and move water around the system to those communities that need it. And without it, we would be looking at probably a 40% shortfall this next year if we were unable to move water around. So we certainly are benefiting this year, and hopefully we'll continue to benefit as we find the need to buy supplemental water. Wanted to give a little update on Lake Kachuma. It's currently at 33% of capacity with 67,000 acre feet. I want you to pay close attention to that number because although there is 67,000 acre feet in there, only about 21,000 acre feet of that is actually available for delivery to the project participants, being Goleta, the city of Santa Barbara, Carpinteria, Montecito. So that chunk of water, when that takes into consideration evaporative losses, taken out of that equation, water that will be released for fish, water that's being stored in there for downstream water rights holders. And so it really quickly gets down to a pretty small chunk of water that's actually available, and that is projected to be available October 2014 going forward.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So, Mr. Hagmark, as I recall from a previous conversation, wasn't there a threshold for about 30,000 acre feet at which we had negotiation points with the Bureau of Reclamation in terms of the fish releases, and is that how we remember that?
That is correct, and that discussion, it's a bullet point on here, discussion with the Bureau of Reclamation concerning fish releases as they pertain to the biological opinion. The biological opinion actually specifies a reduction in fish releases, but the way that the biological opinion was based on was the capacity of the lake, because at the time, the only holders of water in the lake were the project participants. And so what's changed over the years is we aren't the only people who have water now in the lake. And so the question is, and I think to answer your question, which is confusing about this, the 21,000 acre feet that's in there, we have removed evaporation from that. So if you add evaporation in there, we're over 30,000 acre feet of water that's in there for project participants. Mm-hmm. So we have not yet reached that 30,000 acre foot benchmark. And I think that we will be approaching that soon. And that's why we will be meeting with the Bureau to talk with them about implementing the wording in the biological opinion, which calls for looking at the possibility of reducing fish releases.
So that calculation is a little bit debatable, but that...
Right. What I was trying to do is really simplify what was available for our use. Your question is a great question, but there's actually more water in there. I've just taken out a lot of the losses that come out of it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Hotchkiss and Mr. Hart.
Do we have any real leverage with the Bureau of Reclamation? It seems to me they'll just say no.
None. Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hotchkiss, the Bureau, we're in partnership with the Bureau. The Bureau is we're there as a team to implement the biological opinion. So we're going to be working with them to work with NMFS, who would be the discussion point would take place. I know Mrs. Wirk has probably some comments on that.
Generally, I think that's very good. The Bureau operates the project on behalf of the member units as a water supply. Our interests are very aligned. They are interested in meeting their federal obligations to the Endangered Species Act by complying with the biological opinion, but they're equally interested in meeting their customers' needs. So we've had a good, strong partnership for a long time, and they are interested in making that balance.
Well, that's an encouraging answer. Thank you.
And then as part of that conversation with the Bureau, the fact that we are releasing water downstream for downstream water users, that in essentially, you know, that is also serving the needs of the habitat as well? Is that part of the dialogue?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hart, the way that the water rate releases work is they work to offset releases that would otherwise be project water. So the downstream releases, the water rights releases, that's water that's the right of the downstream entities, take away the need for project water to be released. So there is what we call a conjunctive use there, and that is helpful.
Thank you.
So for this water year, which will start October 1st, the member agencies and project participants have agreed to a 55% reduction for us. That's about, we'll be looking for about 3,700 acre feet of water next year from Kachuma. That is reflected in our current supply strategy. With this strategy, we are hoping to sustain water in Kachuma into 2016. And then with one of the big drivers to that is allowing us to continue to convey either state water or supplemental water through Kachuma, because that is basically our conduit for moving water to the South Coast. As I mentioned, we will be talking with the Bureau, hoping to get the discussion going with NMFS about implementing the biological opinion, which looks at possible reductions in fish releases. And water rights release, I just wanted to let the council know that the downstream water rights users will be releasing approximately 6,000 acre feet sometime, I believe, in August here to replenish some of their groundwater. So at this point, I want to just review the drought response capital projects that are going on, starting with recycled water, groundwater projects, desalination plant, and the cone pumping project. So the tertiary treatment plant, just report, it's everything's on schedule at this point to be online the summer of 2015, and to remind the council that the capacity of that facility is 1,400 acre feet per year. We currently do not have demand for 1,400 acre feet. Our demand currently without the El Estero wastewater treatment plant is around 800 acre feet a year is what our current demand is for recycled water. Valverde well, if we continue to move forward with that, it's a well with non-potable water that we are looking to bring online sometime in October to help offset our potable water demands in the recycled water system.
Mr. White has a question.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This just struck me. Is there opportunity to expand the use of reclaimed water we have this year where the construction of the plant's going on, or however many months, most of the year, to put the word out to, I mean, we have our largest single residential customer is right next to the purple pipe. Are there, could there be opportunities to get some of those things teed up during this year so that we are increasing the use of reclaimed water when the plant is ready?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember White, the city did an exhaustive study to see where we would expand our recycled water system, trying to see where it would go in the system and kind of some costs with that. And in general, unfortunately, the nodes of use are far apart, and the cost of extending the system is pretty expensive. Certainly, it's going to be something we're going to be looking at once the system's back online. But the question we've been looking for is grants to helpfully fund those extensions of the water system that would allow us to connect the large user that I believe you're referring to. There would be some recycled water pipe extensions that would need to be done to actually make them a usable candidate. But those infrastructure investments have typically been the city who have taken those on, and so those would be something we would have to discuss going forward.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Groundwater project highlights. Unfortunately, they may all sound kind of negative, but there's actually a lot of great things going on with the groundwater. Alameda well replacement is on schedule to come online in 2015. They have sited a location within the park that doesn't impede any of the current uses. And so that is working its way through design and will come back to council at some point for a findings that it is compatible with park use. High school well is a well that was drilled, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago. It was found to have some really difficult water quality and was put on basically standby until we can figure out a better way to treat that water. We're currently doing some water quality testing, looking at a couple options, basically the idea of running a pipeline from the high school all the way down to our Ortega groundwater treatment plant to treat the water there, but also looking at maybe pumping the well at a lower capacity, therefore kind of getting around some of the sulfide issues that we've had in the past, the hydrogen sulfide issues. So it's looking promising. We might be able to have some small capacity, 100 gallons per minute out of that well in a rather short time frame. Veracruz well, we did have an electrical issue there, which has caused the well to be down. We've moving forward with an emergency PO, which will be back to council at your first session in September for approval. City Hall well, we had a pump failure there, and we are moving forward with an emergency PO to get that pump replaced. We believe that pump is under warranty. However, we're not waiting around to see how that all plays out as we go back and forth to the contractor. We're going to go ahead and just buy another pump, and if we are successful with the contractor, we will get a new pump, and we'll have it on standby in case we have any other pump issues in the future. Upcoming desal project milestones. We talked exhaustively about this last week, but just continue to go review it. September 23rd is going to be a presentation to council in which we'll kind of summarize the findings of the preliminary design, and we'll have some recommendations for the council to move forward. Tentatively, November 2014, we're looking to release a request for proposals for the design, build, operate services. I'll receive those proposals sometime in February. And be prepared as early as April to award a contract if this winter is as dry as the past three. And that would put us online in the summer of 2016 with a capacity of approximately 3,125 acre feet a year. Just to review that little timeline, we are in year three. We are working on the pre-design. Considering award in April of 2015, and the facility would come online in the summer of 2016, producing a small amount of water there, you see. And what this graphic shows that I think is critical is if this winter is dry, and then the winter following that is dry, there will be a recommendation probably to increase the size of the facility all the way up to 7,500 acre feet to meet the shortfall. As you'll see in year six, it becomes critical to this community. They're just we start to really exhaust a lot of our local surface waters, and there really isn't a lot of options to meet our needs without a major major water shortage. What I don't show on here is year 7, where at that point most of our groundwater wells would be exhausted. And so even with desal coming online, we are still looking at a community that will have to conserve. This isn't something that's going to end the drought for us. This is something that's going to allow us to move through a drought and maintain some semblance of this community and its infrastructure.
So following up on Mr. White's point of recycled water, it might be, I mean, worst case scenario, year 7, and if what the cost benefit, what the cost analysis would be of expanding the purple pipes to different areas that that will allow us to save water elsewhere by going from, is it from 800 acre feet to 1400 acre feet? So I mean, that's, you know, that's a lot of water that could be used in a different way. So you know, that's a longer term discussion, but it'd be interesting to know, like, per how much, what does it cost per 10 feet of purple pipe to install? You know, and I don't know if there's a answer that's easy to quantify or not, but I have absolutely no idea how that relates to the cost of the desal plant or anything else. So that'd just be nice information to have.
No, Madam Mayor, I think we hear you guys loud and clear. We'll definitely be bringing something back in a future discussion about that. I do think it's a value point. Just for reference, typically installation of pipe is around $250 a linear foot. And so a mile of pipe is easily over $1 million. So it's a pretty significant cost. We're hopeful that with a lot of the pressure to find other alternatives, we'll see some grants to help us offset the cost of extending that system. But as you mentioned, it is limited. There's 600 acre feet that we could, you know, hope to fully develop the recycled water system. But it is, like you said, it's something.
Yeah, thank you.
So the comb pumping project, that's a Kachuma Operation and Management Board, of which the city is a member. And this is the emergency pump project to continue to allow water to move out of Kachuma into the state south coast. That project is slated to be online at the end of September. There is sufficient capacity in the reservoir to continue to have gravity flows, they're feeling like, into October. I believe that's their comfort level at this point, so we will have this online before that. The total cost of the project to the capital and operational cost to through March of 2015 is $6.1 million. The city's share of that is $2.2 million. I'm pleased to report back that the city has successfully been pre-approved for a $500,000 grant from CDPH, and we will be coming back to council for a resolution to move forward with finalizing that arrangement. Also, and so that $500,000 is just the city's portion, so that will reduce the $2.2 million that we currently owe. But then we've also, as the comb agency, are pursuing a grant for $2 million to reduce that $6.1 million. So hopefully those grants come through. We'll see a significant savings on this emergency pumping project. As part of the project, too, we're looking for elements of the project that we can purchase and leave in place for future droughts to reduce the costs. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to Madeline Ward, our conservation coordinator.
Madam Mayor, members of the council, my name is Madeline Ward, and I'll be giving you a quick update on our conservation program. We're very pleased with the way the community has been reducing water usage, and we're just encouraging everyone to keep up the good work. Currently, we are conducting site visits at all of the Santa Barbara Unified School District schools that are in our service area. We've been working with the school district for many years on irrigation, and this is the first time we get to go inside the building and work with them on their fixtures and their appliances that are inside. So we're currently conducting all the surveys. We look at leaks, any efficiency upgrades in terms of newer technology that's out there. We provide a report with what we recommend, that's something that's cost effective, there's a good return on investment,
And we also offer a rebate on certain upgrades. And this can range from something as simple as fixing a leaking toilet to installing a new commercial ice machine. So this is a really great program. It's part of our commercial, industrial, institutional survey and rebate program. And we're pleased to go through it this summer with the school district before all the kids come back. We also have noticed that the community is very engaged in terms of waste of water. We've, since February, about mid-February, we've received 450 calls and reports on waste of water, or also the stage two violations. And the most common are sprinkler runoff, which is something that we enforce at all times, no matter if we're in a drought or not. But usually we would just get a few a month until about February, and now we're getting a lot more, which is great. People are very cued into it, and they want to make sure that everyone else is following the rules, and it's raised the awareness level a lot. We're very pleased to see that. So we have a couple different ways to do that. We just added another way. Of course, we've always had the conservation hotline number, which is a great one to keep in your cell phone. I call it all the time myself. But really the best thing is photos, because we can't be everywhere at all times, especially we're not really around at 4 a.m. when the water's running down the street, and maybe when we come, it's already dry and we can't even tell that the water was running. So photos can be emailed to wconservation@santabarbaraca.gov. And we created a new online reporting form, which is really handy because you can put in all the information and the photos and a video. We now have a video feature because a lot of people came back saying, I want to upload a video. So the online form is santabarbaraca.gov/reportwater. And we've been getting quite a few a day via that online reporting form.
That work on a smartphone?
Yes, it does work on a smartphone. We're fixing the formatting a little, but that's what it's ideally for, is so you can take the picture and upload it right there.
I think what's critical too, with if you submit or email pictures in, please, the address and the time is also very critical so that we can follow up and be very clear with whoever the violator might be.
And it can also be anonymous. The online form is, there's the option of being anonymous, but some people are putting their contact information in case we need to follow up with questions, which is very helpful. Also, I just want to call your attention to next Monday, August 11th, when we will be having a Water Commission meeting that's focused on conservation. We're inviting the members of the public. We've moved it here to the City Council chambers in order to allow for more people to attend. So it's going to focus on what customers and businesses can do to save water, simple things to do, and then also all the programs that the city has. So that's next Monday, August 11th at 3:00 right here in the council chambers.
Mayor. Go ahead, Ms. Muriel.
Ms. Ward, does that mean that it'll be televised so people can watch it and watch the rerun as well?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Muriel, yes, it will be. It'll be televised, and it'll be on repeat, but we'll also take a snippet of it and put it on our website as well.
Mr. Rouse?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, I can see a fleet of water drones coming out of the city here. Quick question, Ms. Ward. I've got a lot of constituents that ask me about the use of gray water around their people's own residential properties. Could you say something for the public regarding that? The do's and don'ts there. Maybe Ms. Bjork can do that.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rouse, I will actually defer to Madeline. I thought you said Ms. Bjork, but I think you said Ward. So we do have guidance for people who are interested in using gray water at their homes. There's a basic gray water that does not require permitting, but we also have some sample plans on how to do it. And we, if people have questions, certainly our water conservation hotline is the best number for that, 564-5460. But gray water is a great way to stretch your water supply.
So I have one more slide that I'd like to review here. And this has been something that staff has been working on, and this is tools for influencing water usage. Our current plan for reducing water usage was adopted in 2011, and we're moving through that plan, and it's based on two main elements, an economic incentive, which is the conservation-based water rates, which were put into effect July 1st. and the use of regulations on wet water use applications, which is in effect as well as of May 20th. Questions have come up, though, about the use of other methods. There are other communities who are using allocation-based or rationing-based methods for water reduction and or penalties. And staff has gathered quite a bit of information. We've been talking pretty extensively with the city of Santa Cruz, who has a rationing program, a pretty aggressive rationing program, as well as with Montecito, who has a kind of a hybrid that works for their community. But at this point, we would like to come back in September once we've kind of vetted this element a little bit more and have a nice discussion with you in September on the other alternatives that are out there. I will say that I think we are on the right path and we are getting the results that we are looking for, but I think it might be helpful to the council to know what other tools are out there should we get to a point where we've exhausted all of our tools in our toolbox. I don't see that at this point, but I certainly want to be forthcoming about what other opportunities are there.
Great. We do have that was your last slide, correct? Okay. We do have two public comment speaker slips here, Phil Walker and then Ben Pitterly. Come on up.
Good afternoon again, Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. You know, going back to 1990 when we had the vote for state water and desal, I didn't want to tell people I voted for both items, but I'm certainly glad I did now. You cannot have enough water sources. The one thing is the coastal branch of the state water resource aqueduct is a somewhat fragile conveyance. You have approximately 100 miles of steel, cement-lined and coated pipe, welded, circumferential, welded at every 25 feet. I think I remember the sticks were 25 feet. I have a neighbor two blocks down that actually worked on the project. And in the mid-90s, during construction, there were questions raised about the viability of the welds. And you have to remember, too, that the coastal branch moving from east to west, approximately 100 miles, three water tunnels, five steel welded reservoirs, it's actually bisects the San Andreas Fault. They were smart enough to daylight it at that point, but there is a concern in a major event on the San Andreas whether you'll have some downtime on this system. So it's good to have as many different sources of water that you can possibly come up with. Thank you.
Ben Pitterly.
Good afternoon. I'm Ben Pitterly with Santa Barbara Channel Keeper. Generally, we're pleased with the staff report, and I'll elaborate on some points there in a moment. I did want to first, though, just offer a reflection on, I think, a comparison and some questions that I made during my comments at the last board meeting regarding the city's existing landscape rebate program and that of other communities. And I believe when I made that comparison, your staff provided some clarification as to how Santa Barbara's rebate structure is actually established, and it had something to do with the avoidance cost of water. And so that's very helpful to understand. I guess I do want to make the distinction that, you know, though the city's program is set up that way, it doesn't necessarily have to be set up that way. I think there's still perhaps consideration and some questions that could be analyzed as to whether or not augmenting that rebate program could be beneficial. And I know that staff did mention that I think there's like a 10% scheduled increase in the rebate. Based on the city's website, I think the existing rebate's $1,000, so that would bring it to $1,100. By comparison, Oxnard rebate program caps out at $3,000. So just food for thought. I think it still deserves some consideration. And my next point, I think also I just want to be careful to set the tone in these comments. I think it's possible to offer you know, criticism or ask questions without suggesting that staff isn't doing a really stellar job on their conservation programs. I think we're pleased to see that they've achieved the 18% reduction. The city's set a 20% goal. I think that we would all agree, though, that we should recognize that, you know, currently the city's programs are primarily voluntary. And voluntary conservation measures will only, I think we would all agree, will only take us so far. We've set a 20% goal. I'm very pleased to see that staff's beginning to look at some of the other options, allocations, and perhaps penalties and some of those other alternatives that other municipalities are using. As of July 2014, there's 27 other cities in California that are implementing mandatory conservation targets of 20% or more. And there's a long list of agencies. I think staff mentioned they're looking at Santa Cruz's program. Sacramento has a robust program. You can ask people to conserve, given people are going to take into context what the status quo is and conserve what they can. Using a strategic combination of some of these additional mandatory tools, I think you can achieve, probably far exceed that 20% goal. I'll conclude. My only final point, I just wanted to also draw your attention to a letter I think council received from Coastal Protection, California Coastal Protection Network, that identified, I think it's important that everybody, council is understands what the permitting process for the desal plant will accurately be. And I think they identified some issues moving forward that...
Yeah, you're way over your time. Thank you very much. Get the letter today.
Thanks.
Or yesterday. Thank you. Okay. This is just receiving a report. Any other questions or comments from council?
I did, Madam Mayor.
Yeah, Ms. Murillo and then Mr. White.
Thanks. To go back to the groundwater, is the City Hall well or the Veracruz well... Or is that water cleaned or treated through the Ortega plant?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rio, yes, that is correct. Both of those wells require additional filtration and cleaning before we put it in the distribution system.
Okay. And then Mr. Pitterly kind of beat me to the punch there. I wanted to suggest the idea of increasing the conservation goal beyond 20%. And when we come back in September for that presentation to discuss penalties I'm not sure if it's going to rain, but if we conserve, what if we conserved at 40%? Would that keep us from recommissioning the desal plant? It seems like we should start the conversation about getting tougher on our residents. Thank you.
Mr. White.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, it's pretty clear what the city will need to do, will do, if we either have a catastrophic rain year or a miracle. I think those two sides those two bookends are before us. I won't even call it a miracle, just a good rain year. It's going to be that in-between area that's going to be perhaps one where delicate decisions or difficult decisions need to be made. So it's there. That's where, and I think at least the comments that many people have made today about conservation, I think really come to bear. The more we conserve, the more options we're going to have in the out years as we go along with the sort of so-so rain years. The more we conserve now, the more options we're going to have to not incorporate the desal plant, or perhaps to keep it at the smaller size. And instead of three, the small size, we don't have to go up to the big size. So the conserving now is one of our best options. And so I do urge all of us to continue this momentum of going from 15% to 18% conservation. I hope that when we come back in September, we're looking at attaining that 20% goal at least. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll see you in September. Great. Okay, any council member committee assignment reports?
I do want to acknowledge and commend everyone related to Old Spanish Days. I thought it was a really well done last few days. And a lot of people had fun, and our law enforcement, I think, was really helpful and did not hear. We'll get a full report, I'm sure, when we get our police update next month. But things looked really well. And I just want to also commend all the dancers, particularly the Spirit and Junior Spirit. They danced an average, I think, of about 6 or 7 times a day for that full week. And it was pretty amazing. I had the opportunity to share the carriage with the Junior Spirit, Natalie, during the parade. And you could tell she was excited and tired all at once, but it was great. And she was amazing, 10 years old and already extremely talented dancer. So any other committee assignment reports? Okay. We have a couple of closed session items to read and some public comment on one of them. So if you could read those first.
Item 24, conference with city attorney regarding people of the state of California, city of Santa Barbara versus East Side, West Side et al., SBSC case number 1379826. Item 25, conference with city attorney regarding Frank Benales, Sebastian Aldana Jr., Jacqueline Inda, Cruzito Herrera Cruz, and Benjamin Chaveras versus the city of Santa Barbara et al., SBSC case number 1468167. And item 26, conference with labor negotiator.
Okay, so this public comment's all on item 24. And just to say right up front, there has been no decisions yet on anything related to the recent judgment on the gang injunction. So just to clarify, we'll start with Valenca Castaneda, be followed by Cindy Gonzalez. And thank you for your patience.
Cindy's not here, but I'll speak for the rest of the group.
What's your name?
I said my name is Valeska, but Cindy won't be speaking.
Oh, okay.
We had to leave.
Sure, and then Brandon Morse will be after you then.
Yes. So as I said before, my name is Valeska, and I'm the founder of A Trail for Humanity. And it is a walk that started on July 22nd from Merced, and we are walking more than 375 miles to the border. Today is our 14th day. We have walked 214 miles, and we routed our stop here. And one of the reasons was because of the gang injunction, which had passed, and the community wanted to embrace us and celebrate, one of their milestones. However, when we reached Santa Barbara, they let us know that there was an appeal made on the decision. So even though I had to shower 2 hours ago to have a press conference and meet, I felt it was very critical for me to stay and continue to leave my humanitarian message as I have in all the other 41 cities that I've stopped at. And what I'm asking the mayor and the city council is to please take a stand, as I've taken a stand for communities that aren't even mine, and imploring for humanity against these racial profile policies that are being implemented. Thank you.
Thank you. Brandon Morse, and is Maricela Garcia here? Ms. Martin, okay. So after... Right, I'm just asking if you're here. So you're yielding your time to Mr. Morse, correct? Okay, and then Soxeli Romero? She's not here. Violeta Alvarez? She's not here. Ron Scanlon or Sanchez? Okay, you'll be after Mr. Morse. Mr. Morse, you have up to 4 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. I have to say I'm just very, very disappointed where we're standing right now.
I just want to clarify once again, there's been no decision.
Can I give my
yet.
10 seconds back,
please? I'm going to give you your 10, but just so you know, there's been no decision. That's what this closed session is about, okay?
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Madam Mayor, members of the City Council, I would like to say that I'm very disappointed that we are standing here right now, even considering doing an appeal. The last time that we were here, we had hundreds of people. We've had hundreds of people that have exercised their First Amendment right. They've came here. They have petitioned their representatives for redress, and their representatives have rejected us, except for a couple of them. And I would like to recognize Councilmember Murillo and Councilmember Hart for taking a stand and reflecting the will of the people. The last time we were here, there were several of you on the City Council that said, we just want to see what the judge wants to say. At the end of the day, win or lose, we're all friends, right? That was what was, I believe Mr. White was the one that made that comment. So whenever we won, which we knew we were going to win, I was really surprised to even hear that there was even a possibility of an appeal. You guys have spent almost $1 million, $750,000 for sure. We aren't exactly sure how much Cam Sanchez and his police department has spent on this effort. And you lost. If you go to appeal it, we already have the funds to fight you. And then the people are going to be very, very upset. And you think that we've had a lot of people out here before. It's just going to be twice, three times that size. At the end of the day, there's a few things that were mentioned today that I think are worthy of readdressing for one second. One, it seems that the disabled and other people in our community are having trouble finding housing, yet you want to spend money on the gang injunction, trying to appeal it. The police are wanting to fund their salaries, and you want to spend more money fighting the gang injunction. Let's see here, what else? You mentioned earlier, ask and ye shall receive. We are asking you to represent the will of the people. There was one person that came out and spoke out in support of the gang injunction, and this body has utilized this anonymity of some random people that we can't confront. We don't have a right to confront our accusers here because you guys take it into a closed session, and the people that you are saying are supporting the gang injunction refuse to come out here to be open in the dialogue, to have the discussion. Several of you bet your political careers on this. One of you lost. Do we want to have more people lose their political careers over this? I don't believe so. I think what we need to do is we need to understand that we, the people, are demanding action right now. Let's see here. Oh, another thing that was mentioned earlier is this idea of the executive, the legislative, and the judicial branches colluding together in closed session. The fact that the mayor, the city council, and the city attorney are going into an area that the public cannot hear what's happening, I believe is inappropriate. Wow. What else is going on here? Orange County spent over $3.3 million in the appeal, and they lost that as a waste of public funds. We are going to submit PRAs. We are going to flood this city with requests. We are going to cost this city so much money if you guys decide to go forward on the appeals. The appeal process is just going to be a drop in the bucket. It really is. I really would implore you, for once, in the 3 years that we've been coming here, listen to the people. For once. Because I guarantee you, whenever the individuals that stood up for the people go to re-election, they're going to have the support of the people. People are going to knock on doors. They're going to register people to vote, no matter what political party they're associated with. I walked 200 miles. 200 miles I walked to get here today. Please excuse the fact that I'm a little disheveled. Please excuse the fact that most of the mothers decided that they needed to be nice and clean for our rally tonight. And I would hope that all of you guys join us at 6 o'clock, Casa de la Raza. Thank you.
Juan Scanlon will be followed by Kathy. Kathy Smith will be the final speaker.
Good afternoon. My name is Juan Sandoval. Good afternoon, Chairman and City Council. Brandon is correct. You were elected by the people to represent the people, and obviously, at this point, you're not doing that. I've been in education for 30 years, and this gang injunction is not too different from what school districts do when you have situations in school where, rather than putting programs in place to promote growth with students, it's the old ideology of getting rid of the 5% and everything will be okay after that. Well, we know what happens with that 5% when they get shipped out. Okay, they come back to society untrained, and it creates problems. So rather than spending the money on an appeal, put the money to use to provide programs for individuals to prevent as what you refer to as gangs. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Okay? There's no reason for you to even consider an appeal. Obviously, it went through the motion. There were arguments, and the arguments led to the fact that this injunction is not just. And as we know where, what it's going to lead to. It's going to lead into a racial profile, especially here in an area such as Santa Barbara, which is not good for our youth. It's not good for the public. And overall, please plan. Do not fail to plan, because that's what's going to happen. You're planning to fail. And I do belong to MAPA, Mexican American Political Association. I was looking at the demeanor as we started discussing this. And what you say here in open session is not necessarily what's going on in closed session. So I'm anxious to see what's going to happen on this, because we already contacted Ben Benavides, our state emeritus president, and our state president, Ralph Villavitia, about the situation that we even celebrated in Fresno when we heard about it. Okay? Thank you for your time.
Kathy Swift.
Yeah, I guess I want to repeat what Brandon said in terms of my disappointment that you guys are now not only going to go against the will of the people, but also against the judge who ruled against the city on this because you failed to make the case. The city, and so I guess I'm just going to remind you of why you failed to make the case for the gang injunction, since you seem to have forgotten. And that is, one, you failed to provide irrefutable evidence that Latino gangs are threatening the lives of Santa Barbara citizens, as you allege. Citizens have spoken out against this. The judge listened, and you have not been able to make a case that people are hiding in fear in their houses, that people have to change their walking directions, and that people have to do all this extra accommodation because they live in fear of gangs. You failed to present that case, and that's why the judge ruled against it. Another thing that the city failed to establish was the idea that the Mexican mafia is working here now in conjunction with Santa Barbara gangs. This was not proven at all. This is pure speculation, but in their gusto to do this, to get this passed, and their enthusiasm to do this, there's even these ridiculous allegations now that the Mexican mafia is somehow involved with Santa Barbara gangs. Not proven. The city also failed to prove that Mr. X was a credible witness. Judge Colleen Stern determined that he was basically operating in his own self-interest, that he admitted on the stand that the reason why he was there was the police said that he would get a better deal with his sentencing if he spoke out in behalf of the gang injunction. So you provided a witness that wasn't even credible, and she ruled against that. Another thing that you failed to do was conduct neighborhood surveys. Even other cities that got up there and spoke on behalf of the gang injunction at least even conducted surveys ahead of time to determine if the neighborhoods felt that there was some kind of threat. Santa Barbara did not do that, although in the case of the before Judge Colleen Stern, apparently the city attorney tried to say that they did in fact do these surveys. They did not.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
That concludes the public comment item. We'll go down to closed session, and we'll be adjourning from there. We don't have any meetings scheduled until September. Thank you.
And watches the ship that goes sailing somewhere beyond the sea. She's there watching for me. If I could fly like birds on high, then straight to her arms I'd go sailing. It's far beyond the star, it's near beyond the moon. I know beyond as before, happy we'll be beyond the sea, and never again I'll go sailing.
treats me sweet and gentle the way he should. I got it bad, and that ain't cool. My poor heart is not made of wood. I got it bad, and that ain't good. And when the weekend's over,
I won't know sweet music until you return.
Tony, you're awesome. You still, and so is Susan. Okay. Okay. I'm going to reconvene the open session. We had a closed session on the gang injunction, and the city council voted unanimously not to appeal the gang injunction decision. The City Council accepts and respects the court's decision. We will continue to use all of our law enforcement resources to protect the residents of Santa Barbara from gang violence. And that's all the reportable items from closed session. We will now recess back into closed session for the last item and adjourn from there. Thank you.